Chapter 3, 1920 through 1927. The Journey Begins. One might guess that the life of a young black baseball player in the 1920s was a difficult one. It was. It was also a dream come true for most black youngsters with athletic talent. While most laborers, regardless of color, could expect to make little more than a dollar a day, black ball players were paid from $50 to $200 a month to travel the country and play the game they held a passion for. The segregation and verbal abuse made things difficult at times, but added to the adventure. Pull into a small town, beat the local baseball stars, drive off into the sunset. They were the cowboys of their time. In 1946, sports writer Jimmy Powers made this assertion about Jackie Robinson, recently signed by the minor leagues Montreal Royals. Quote, "Robinson will not make the major leagues. He is a 1,000-to-1 shot at best. The Negro League players simply do not have the brains or skill." Attitudes about black ball players were similar in 1920 when Ted Radcliffe started his career, only not as enlightened. One St. Louis Post-Dispatch reporter wrote during the 20s that, quote, "The time is apparently coming when baseball shall be known as the great African game. It is baseball that the descendant of Ham is at his athletic best. Less removed from the anthropoid ape, he gets down on ground balls better, springs higher for liners, has a much stronger and surer grip, and can get in and out of a base on all fours in a way that makes the higher product of evolution look like a bush leaguer." It was from this climate of racial ignorance that Theodore Roosevelt Radcliffe spawned one of baseball's most amazing careers. In 1920, baseball was making what could be called its last great change. The dead ball, which was a bit mushy and didn't travel far, was replaced with a tightly wound ball built for flight. As a result, playing for one run was replaced by playing for the big inning, led by the king of the big inning, Babe Ruth. Instead of blooping balls over the infield, major leaguers began rolling up their sleeves and attacking the ball, and Major League Baseball hasn't changed since. Black baseball was a little slower in completely shifting to this new style, though, preferring to play a combination of a power and speed game. Daring base running stayed in most black teams' repertoires, and home run hitters were expected to be accomplished bunters like everyone else. Rube Foster's Chicago American Giants were the perfect example of the Negro League style of play. Foster, a charming man off the field, was a driving manager who demanded relentless speed and hustle on the field. During practice, Foster would place his hat down near the baselines and have his batters bunt into it. Most Giants players became such expert bunters that they could roll bunts into the hat like a professional golfer does 10-foot putts. According to one American Giant, Foster once bet $1,000 that his team could beat the mighty Kansas City Monarchs without ever hitting a ball out of the infield. The bunt fest, according to the player, ended with a Chicago win 1-0. Besides daring bunting and base running, black baseball also refused to totally abandon the roughneck style from the days of Ty Cobb. Going into bases with sharpened spikes flying, bean balls, and baseball doctoring remained commonplace in the Negro Leagues, and games often had more of the feel of a Civil War battle than a ball game. While many white baseball reporters of the time refused to admit that the Negro League game was up to Major League standards, they usually conceded that it was more exciting. Harry Salinger of the Detroit News wrote, "Negro Leaguers play with a verve, genuine zest, wholehearted enthusiasm, and flair lacking in the big leagues." Saul Davis started his baseball career in 1919 and had his greatest success as an infielder with the Chicago American Giants. Here's a clip of an interview I had with Mr. Davis in the 1990s in which he describes the roughneck style of play in the Negro Leagues.
That's all the different brand of baseball than what it is now.
Do you think it's better back then?
Oh, sure, you had better ball players. You see, the ball players now has got so much protection. Ball players now can't even get out of the way of a fastball. You know what I mean? Well, they get hit by it and then they want to fight. Well, that's no good. But you see, we had to dodge them fast pitchers. We couldn't stand up there and dig a hole and blow your bubble gum. You know, eat your peanuts and stuff like that. We couldn't have that. You bring that in the dugout, you went on. See, they got the headgear, they got the gloves, and they got the shoes now. Good Lord.
Wouldn't you have wanted to wear a helmet back then, though, if they had them?
What for? I don't want to go contracted with no seamen or nothing. I'm a sportsman. I want to play ball. If you can outsmart me on the ball field, then that's different. See, then, too, we had in our league, we had pitchers could throw more than just three balls, screwball, and you notice when they start to knuckleball, how many of them hit it? See, we had the knuckleball, the screwball, the spitball, the shine ball, and fork ball, fastball, curveball. We had all of them, and you had to dodge a lot of them. See, this is it. The players today don't have to dodge nothing. I have nothing against no ball players, because the money they're making, we couldn't make it out of mine. I'm not saying that they shouldn't have it. I'm glad to see them getting it, you know, but the thing about it is I don't think they're earning it. You know what I mean? See, it's they can stay in there a year or two and be a millionaire. I came up in there in 1919 and stayed to 1955, and I can't pay $45 a night for a room. You know, it's funny. I noticed the ball players that's in the American National League now, they're just as much different as night and day as was when we were playing. When we put that uniform on, you was no relation, you was no cousin, nobody's friend on that diamond. But when we got off of that diamond, we were just like brothers and cousins. Because we had some heck of a ball player. And I mean dangerous ball player. You stay out of their way.
The first professional team I played for was the Illinois Giants, which was operated by a white man. It was a semi-pro team. We weren't in any league. It's an all-black team except for one Indian boy we picked up. The way I got discovered, I used to play every day at a sandlot on 33rd and Wentworth, just down the street from my house. The owner of the Illinois Giants came to the park where we were playing. They're getting ready to start the season and wanted to have a practice game, so they asked if we'd play them. I pitched and I struck out every man on the team. Owner came up to me and said, "We want you. We need a good pitcher like you. Do you want to come play with us?" I ran home and asked my daddy. I was only 18 and I had to get his permission. He knew that I wanted to play ball, so he said, "Go on." That was in April of 1920, and I didn't quit till 36 years later. On the Illinois Giants, we traveled in a big old school bus. There were 14 men on the team, 7 on each side and the equipment in the back. The boss drove, but after a while, he taught me how to drive, and I drove most of the time because I didn't need much sleep. I played with the Illinois Giants from 1920 to 1926. We got paid $50 for every 15 games we played and 50 cents a day to eat on. I wound up getting $250 a month after I stayed out there 4 years. The Illinois Giants played most in Southern Illinois, Wisconsin, Minnesota, North Dakota, and on into Canada. We just traveled all around playing from town to town. We'd split the gate 60-40, 60% for the winners and 40% for the losers. I never will forget one time we played a game in Billings, Montana, and then we drove to Cheyenne, Wyoming. We were up in those mountains, and there was a rock slide, and we had to stop the car. We were out moving the rocks when a big mountain lion came after us. We all jumped in the car, and the lion sat on top of the car and was growling. I said, "Well, somebody go get me a girl, because I ain't moving. I'm sleeping right here." We had to wait now before you got bold and ran off. I remember playing in Minneapolis in 1921. We played at the fairgrounds. They had quarter horses running around while we were playing. I used to go to a place in Minneapolis owned by a man named Crump. It was $1 on one side and $2 on the other side for the pretty girls. I always went for the $2 because I was making more than the rest. I didn't drink or smoke, but I was a ladies' man. I always liked nice clothes, and I ain't never had enough girlfriends. I was just like a cat. When I went into a town, I was a good ball player, and I could get the pick of the girls. There wasn't too much money to be made in those days, but When I was with one of those pretty young gals, I was happy. Red Haley started out with me in 21 with the Illinois Giants. He was a hell of a ball player, clean-cut guy. Married a young white girl, nice hitter, left-handed hitter and could hit left-handed pitching. Listen, nobody can teach you how to hit. You have to have some ability, but the main thing is you got to live a clean life and work hard and obey your parents, because charity begins at home. If you can't listen to your daddy and mom after they raise you and bring you into the world, you ain't nothing. I advise kids to listen to their parents and stay home. Don't fool with drugs and don't rush about no sex, because time will take care of itself. Now, people may not believe this, but I was 18 years old before I had a girl, because I was so enthused with baseball and practicing every day. I didn't think about girls till I got to Chicago, when I got my first girl. No one was in the house but me and my daddy, but my daddy was okay. I told him, look out for me. He said, go ahead. That's the first time I ever got a girl. I married her, but I didn't stay with her. She married another boy, and they had 13 kids. How you gonna take care of 13 kids? She was a nice girl, though. Her name was Verona Higgins. She always liked me. It was on the Illinois Giants that I learned how to throw the scratch ball. A white boy named Murphy taught me how to throw that in 1921 up in a town called Traverse City, Michigan. He taught me how to hold it on one side to make it go down, another side to make it break to the left. I'd use a small piece of sandpaper to scratch the ball, and once I got it down, I became the best. That's why they call me the Emery King, because every time I threw it, no one hit anything out. Did I ever get caught? No. They tried to, but they couldn't. I'd stick a piece of gum on a piece of sandpaper or emery and stick it inside my glove. Then if an umpire came out to the mound, I just put my hand down and slid it off onto the ground. I could make the ball break up 2 or 3 inches, break down or break out. See, you just scratch it on either side with a little piece of sandpaper and it'll sail like a shell. Hold it on the seam instead of across the seam. But you're holding a special way to make it break up, down, in, or out. What makes it so hard to hit? It's like hitting a knuckleball, except you throw it as hard as your fastball.
On the subject of throwing an Emery ball, here is Negro League umpire Bob Motley.
I know to detect anything like that. I have checked some of his ball, and I didn't find anything was cut or mishandling in any kind of way. That's all I remember about, telling the batter they can expect for a curveball, fastball, or knuckleball or something, and he go ahead on and strike them out. That's what he brag about, the way he can pitch. That's the only thing I can remember about.
I threw my fastball around 95 miles an hour. Satcher threw over 100. I had the best control of anybody in the world, ever. I had a curveball, drop ball, and I had, they call it a slider now, we call it an in-shoot. Just throw it hard enough, it'll break. The Illinois Giants didn't want me to leave, but in 1926, I went in Negro League for a month with the Detroit Stars. Bingo DeMoss, the manager of the Detroit Stars, lived 2 blocks from me, and I've been knowing him since I was playing on the sandlots. He's a good friend of mine, and he was trying to get me to play with him, but I was with the Illinois Giants and was traveling to North Dakota. That was so nice. I didn't want to leave, but finally I went with Bingo. He is one of the greatest players who ever lived. He played from 1910 to 1930. One of the greatest second basemen and a great manager. He taught me a lot. When I went with him in 1926, I never will forget. I had a pair of shoes, 2 pair of pants, and a couple of shirts, and I told him, just like I'm telling you, I can't go away out of town like this. I don't have enough clothes to go away. He took me to the pawn shop, the Eli pawn shop. He bought me 2 used shoes for $25 and a pair of flow shams. The first time I ever wore Tom McCann's. He dressed me up and I ended up playing for him for 3 years. But I wanted more money because I had a white friend that liked me in Detroit. He used to scout with the Detroit Tigers. He told me, Ted, you should be getting more than $200 a month. The way you can pitch, catch, and hit, you ought to be the highest paid man. So I asked for $250 and Bingo wouldn't pay it, so I quit. And I went back out in the country with the Illinois Giants for another year. A few times I took off and played for other teams when they called for me. I remember in 1926, Satchel was pitching with the Chattanooga Black Lookouts, and the kid that had catching him was missing every other pitch. Very few catchers could catch that man when he was young. It was like catching a bullet. Satchel told his manager, get me someone who can catch me. Manager said, like who? He said, get Ted Radcliffe. So they called me up, and I caught him a few games, and then met back up with the Illinois Giants in Wisconsin. I left the Illinois Giants for good in 1927, and they broke the team up because I was the drawing card. I really enjoyed playing with the Illinois Giants. That part of the country, Minnesota, Wisconsin, and Canada, it's really something. But we had trouble in a lot of towns. Traveling was tough back then. When we were playing in southern Illinois and Indiana, it's just like Mississippi. You had to go to the back of a grocery store to get a bologna sandwich. Segregation is pretty bad when you got to go to the back of a grocery store for a sandwich. The black ball players caught hell, but we kept playing. We had to play because you couldn't make no money working. We had to do the best we could. We couldn't get no hotel, couldn't take no bath. I gone 4 or 5 days at a time without taking a bath. Back in those days, they used to have barbershops where you could take a bath for a quarter. Some of the white people would let me take a bath because they'd feel sorry for me. Two or three of us would go in there. They used to have a sign in Illinois down by East St. Louis along the railroad said, no niggers allowed. You know, the dictionary says that anyone can be a nigger if they're low grade, but the white man put it on us to degrade us. Didn't bother me, but they did it. We were treated bad. Oh, it was awful. I don't like to talk about it sometimes, because when I think about how much money players are making a day and they can't do nothing, and what we had to go through, it's a joke. I played in the league for 36 years, and the most I made in the U.S. was $850 a month. I was a pitcher, catcher, manager, secretary, and helped drive the bus. And I was happy to get that money because it was tops in those days. Most of the players made $250 to $300 a month. I had one player, Jimmy Crutchfield, a good friend of mine, tell me that the most he ever made was $300 a month. He played 22 years and was a hell of a player. Would have made the big leagues easy. They get more money now for eating than we got for playing. And they can't throw strikes. They can't bunt. And they got so many wild pitches that you'd think the catcher was an in on a football team. Baseball's a joke now. They getting the money, but I don't envy them. I'm living good, but it was a long struggle. You know, when we played, they didn't keep records either. There were no reporters to travel with the teams. The Chicago Defender and the Pittsburgh Courier, two color papers, sometimes would cover the games on Saturday and Sunday. Sometimes. Fay Young was a writer for the Chicago Defender. He's a good friend of mine. He gave us some good write-ups. Wendell Smith wrote for the Pittsburgh Courier, and he's a good friend, too. Abe Saperstein of the Harlem Globetrotters got Smith a job at the Chicago Tribune, and he got the big head. But I never had no problems with him because I didn't need him. I always had a job and was always popular. But blacks didn't get much publicity. We come a long way. A fella named Howe would keep records, statistics and everything, when they got the money to pay him. The white papers, all the news that fit to print except colored baseball. They pretended like we didn't exist. Statistics don't mean anything anyway. I'll tell you what matters. When the season rolls around, is there a team that wants you to play? If there is, then you're good enough. If no one wants you, then you ain't. I have a mind like a possum. I remember almost every game I ever played. I know what happened because I was there. I lived it for 36 years. We stuck in there till Jackie Robinson got in the big leagues in 47, and now the door's opening up. They're treating us like men. You know, little towns all over the country would want us to come and play ball. And then after we'd whip their teams, they'd throw rocks at us and call us names as we were leaving. I never will forget. 1924, we were up at a place called Bear Creek in Wisconsin, where people used to go fishing and hunting. Beautiful place. We went there to play the local team, and the chief of police came down to our dugout. I was managing the Illinois Giants by that time. That's the first team I managed. The chief said, "If you beat us, we're going to whip you niggas' asses." That's the words he used. So I called the guy on our team, Murphy, down to the dugout, and I told him to go uptown and get two state police. They came, and we had one in our dugout and one in theirs. The state police said, "You go ahead and play ball. Nothing's going to happen to you." We run them out. We beat them 21-0. The fans didn't do anything to us, but they called us all kind of names. We had a tough time, but the reason I kept playing was mostly because there's no work. You will make over $1 a day. I was making $250 a month. That was a lot more then. And then you could get the girls because they came looking for you even way back then. And you know you enjoyed being with the ladies if you were a man. So I shuffled out there 36 years. It was a hard journey. There's another white guy, Robert Gilkerson, had the Gilkerson's Union Giants. They were a traveling team out of Spring Valley, Illinois. I played with them off and on from 1927 to 1929. We traveled all over the Midwest and Canada. We could have beaten any team in any league. Gilkerson gave me my first $300 a month. A lot of great players played with them over the years. Red Haley, Hurley McNair, Art and Charlie Hancock, George Giles, Steel Arm Davis, Cristobal Torriente. Oh, we had great teams. Hardly ever lost a game.
During Ted Radcliffe's tenure with Gilkerson's Union Giants, he had the great fortune of being tutored by a black baseball legend named Clarence Pops Coleman. Coleman, 25 years Radcliffe senior, was born in 1877 and became a star pitcher on the sandlots of Louisville, Kentucky. One day, his team's catcher failed to show for a game, and Coleman volunteered for duty and stayed a catcher for the next 40 years. Homestead Grays utility man Bill Happy Evans listed both Radcliffe and Coleman as Negro Leaguers who should be in the Hall of Fame. Coleman, who spent his best years as a catcher for legends John Donaldson on the All Nations and Dick Redding on the Indianapolis ABCs, moved to the Union Giants and continued to catch into his 50s. In his final years, Coleman spent hours developing a young catcher named Ted Radcliffe into one of the best backstops in baseball history. Because of the equipment used in the 1920s, catching was a much tougher position to master than it is today. Catcher's gloves looked like round leather pillows with an indentation in the center just big enough to hold a baseball. They were built more to avoid the pain of catching a fast pitch than to actually catch the pitch. As a result, two hands were always necessary to caress the ball into the glove and keep it from popping out. Low pitches were especially hard to handle, as merely sticking the glove out would only result in knocking the ball further away. Good footwork was absolutely necessary in order to get in front of balls, and Radcliffe was drilled repeatedly until his movements behind the plate were second nature. In an effort to avoid racial incidences, several black traveling teams of the time felt the need to clown and perform while playing white teams, reasoning that a smiling, laughing crowd was a less violent one. It was black baseball, after all, that first introduced base coaches not only to help runners and give signs, but to entertain crowds with a constant line of chatter. In the 1920s, when the Illinois Giants visited Winona, Minnesota, the local paper extolled of the Giants, quote, "Their comic antics on the coaching lines are more than a circus." Another reason that black teams sometimes clown during games was because they usually were far superior in talent to their white semi-pro opponents. Black teams were known to purposely let their opponents get ahead by 4 or 5 runs early in a game, only to pull the game out in dramatic fashion late in the game, resulting in everyone thinking the game was closer than it was, and increasing the chances that the black team would be invited back again. Norman Lumpkin was a star outfielder with the Atlanta Black Crackers and New York Black Yankees, and in this interview I had with him in the 1990s, he explains how the ability to act was sometimes just as important as the ability to hit or pitch in order to survive in black baseball.
And there were times, in 2000, there were certain times where we were treated beautifully, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Even in Georgia here, say a place like Dalton, Georgia. Up there where they make those carpets.
Uh-huh.
And carpets and bedspreads and so forth. Now I can give them credit, boy. They would really come out and they would really treat you like real people. We would always go in and, like gentlemen, play. But a lot of times when we'd catch a lot of abuse, then that was the time when we would try to beat the holy hell out of the team. You understand?
Uh-huh.
We would run them like rabbits. But all the time, pretend like, you know, well, we weren't enjoying it. And then get on the bus and laugh like this. You know what I mean?
Uh-huh.
We were good actors. You had to be a good actor to survive. And, but we've learned the hard way, because if you run the score up and act like you beat them, those people really, they would run your ass out of town, see?
Radcliffe played in every one-horse town in the Midwest while with the Illinois Giants and the Gilkerson's Union Giants, and it often seemed that the smaller the town, the worse the treatment. Newspapers in small Minnesota towns and Wisconsin towns had advertisements for games against Gilkerson's Union Giants on one page and advertisements for KKK picnics on the next. Some black teams even played as part of KKK weekend celebrations. Small-town newspapers, consistent with many of their readers, often describe blacks in animal-like terms. A Minnesota newspaper, reporting on a heated game between Gilkerson's Union Giants and the tiny town of Sherburne, said, quote, "The trouble seemed to have started when the locals met the Coons in Windham. The boys said it was their game, but the ump had robbed them of it. Bad blood was evident from the start, and it's possible the only thing that saved them from being cut off from earthly existence was the fact that the Coons were in the minority." In the 1920s, the Midwest was a popular territory for more than 100 traveling teams of all races and talent levels, and teams that used gimmicks were often the most successful. A few of the more clever teams were the various all-nation teams with different nationalities at every position, the House of David teams, in which the players wore long beards, and a team that misleadingly advertised themselves as the Joliet Prison Team. A newspaper reporter reported, quote, "The supposed prisoners were not prisoners at all, and some of them do not know any more about Joliet than a hog on Sunday. Not one had ever held up a pedestrian or robbed a bank or even shot at a policeman," unquote. It seemed the bigger the novelty, the bigger the crowds. Of course, many people viewed being black in itself a novelty, and black teams usually were the biggest draws. Ted Radcliffe's years with the Illinois Giants and Gilkerson's Union Giants could be looked upon as being akin to a white player's minor league career, in which the traveling was exhausting, the competition fair to middling, and every game was another lesson on baseball's finer points. After years of polishing, a young player was hopefully ready for the big time. After his many years with the Illinois Giants and Gilkerson's Union Giants, Ted Radcliffe was ready for the big time.